Welcome, everyone. We're so delighted that you could join us today. We'll get started in just 1 minute. My name is Jennifer Rigg, and I serve as Executive Director at the Global Campaign for Education US. Welcome to the Global Disability Summit Inclusive Education Thematic Workshop. We're really delighted that you could join us today. It is my pleasure to thank everyone who has made this workshop possible today. And please join me in thanking all of the co-sponsors, which you can see listed here on the next slide. Interpretation is available with international sign, thanks to the Global Campaign for Education Secretariat and Catholic Relief Services and all of the professionals joining us today. We'd like to extend a special thank you to the Disability Rights Fund and Disability Rights Advocacy Fund for providing CART and closed captioning. If my colleague might be able to move us to the next slide, we can see and honor and thank all of the co-hosts and co-sponsors, thank you so much, that have made today's session possible. We're especially grateful to the Global Disability Summit Secretariat and all colleagues who have made this session possible to really feature and highlight the importance of inclusive education and disability inclusive education in the lead up to next month's Global Disability Summits. All of us today are working together to ensure that all young people, all learners around the world, especially those with disabilities, can fully access inclusive education and the right to education. We have a few immediate logistics on the next slide that we'll go through. Most of you, all of you can access interpretation within the Zoom button for selecting the interpretation language in Arabic, French, Spanish, Portuguese, or English. All of the event materials are available online, and we'll share those links directly with you in the chat box here in Zoom as well. But the key materials for the event are at bit.li/gds-ie for Global Disability Summit Inclusive Education. Please use the Zoom webinar Q&A or questions and answer panel for any questions that you might have of speakers as we go through the workshop today. And please do follow along and help amplify on social media with the hashtag GDSIE for Global Disability Summit Inclusive Education. More details can be found in the social media toolkit, which we will share through the chat box as well. You are all invited to join the Inclusive Education and Early Childhood Community of Practice. And today's co-sponsors and Community of Practice members have developed a proposed call to action with recommendations from the thematic workshop on inclusive education today. We will share that link in the chat box, and they request any feedback to finalize the call to action by January 26th. We're so delighted that you all could join us today, and we really want to hear from each of you about the work that you're doing on disability inclusive education right from the start, specifically as advocates, as champions across the globe to make sure that we're really ensuring the right to education for everybody. It is my pleasure to welcome our first speaker today, Rafat Sabah, the president of the Global Campaign for Education. Over to you, Rafat.
Thank you, Jennifer. And I am really happy that this year this subject has been raised. Actually, this issue was one of the main issue that we discuss all over the world, because this pandemic actually revealed the veil on the fragility of the educational system, not the educational systems. Actually, it revealed on the health systems, on the social development systems. That's why GCE has been taking this subject seriously to be one of the key issues that GCE has been working on it. The people with disability issues, not just in the strategical planning of GCE, but rather than it is part of our strategical thinking, our strategical beliefs, our concept that we carry in order to achieve education for all. The issue of people with disability, it exists in everywhere as a challenge for the civil society as a whole. This issue should be taking seriously that most of the educational system in all over the world, they are not really adapting this issue, because always, and what this is what the pandemic has revealed, that the system always they ask the people themselves to adapt themselves to the system, while GCE asking that the systems itself should be adapted to the people needs. And this is one of the things that GCE has been working on. All of us know that all, yani, maybe 240 million people with disability in this world, half of them, they are out of the school. And the GCE really believes that regardless of the ability, all children have the human rights to quality and equal education. Yet children and youth with disability are often overlooked in policymaking, restricting their access to education and their ability to participate in social and economic and political life. The world has failed to achieve the justice for these people. Still, there is 186 million, as UNESCO has mentioned, they didn't complete their primary school. This is in a normal situation. You can imagine what the situation in those countries who live in conflict and wars, in context of emergency, including conflict, displacement, and disaster education, is frequently interrupted or denied. And the international community has often failed to ensure the human rights to education for those living in emergency situation. Children and youth are usually the most affected through emergency situation, especially people displaced or in situation of conflict and crisis, also affect teachers and adult learners. Among them, children with disabilities are routinely denied their right to education. So they miss out in these critical and often life-saving interventions. Some studies also show that in refugee camps, for instance, girls with disability are less likely to attend the school than boys with disability. DC uphold that educational system should respond positively to pupil diversity and approach individual differences as opportunities to enrich learning for all, giving that 9 out of 10 children with disability are out of school, and 80% of all children with disability live in developing countries. GCE recognizes lack of inclusivity and challenges that threat to the human rights to education. Children, adult and youth with disability are often excluded from education and society due to the physical, ideological, systematic, or communication barriers. But they are also faced with stigma and prejudice. In order to achieve the right to people with disability, for the GCE, it's very key, and it's a core element, because without achieving the right to the people with disability, we will not be able to achieve the SGD4. This is a critical issue, and all of us should know, because in this pandemic, those people has been affected much more than the others, and all the educational system, they should know that. The GCE has been built in intervention on 5 directions. The first direction is to make immunity inside the GCE regarding this issue. So making the capacity building for our members, building the attitude, the belief, the skills is one of the core work for GCE to build really the immunity, the internal immunity of GCE. The second thing is to make this issue part of the our advocacy, not just additional image, but it should be part, and it is part of GCE advocacy strategy. The third, GCE worked to make their voice is heard and recognized by the educational system. And that's why we are work, not just at the global level, but also we work at the regional, national, and the local level. That's why we nationalized and we localized our advocacy. The fourth one, it's we are reinforcing all the networks all over the world who is really interested in supporting the people with disability. And what we are doing, we are trying to push those networks, those organizations who is working in the people with disability to be the leaders, not just to be a members in GCE, but to be at the decision-making level. That's why GCE, for them, the issue of the people with disability issue is part of our strategical thinking. Also, all these things is need funding, is need really financing support. And that's why GCE also is taking in their consideration this one. We had been working in many countries in different activity regarding this. I cannot mention maybe all the examples, but I can mention that in some country like Somal, they succeed to develop position paper and to be adopted by the government. In Palestine, in Vietnam, all these, this is some of the example that we succeed as the GCE members to make a process. We know that the way is still long, but we are there and we will reach there.
Thank you so much, Rifat. We really appreciate your remarks.
If you give me just half minute, I will see that's what we mean by nobody will be left behind. This means that we have to working on different level, at the curriculum level, at the teacher level, at the infrastructure level, at the values, at the attitude, and also the GCE. I can say as a president of GCE that we are strongly and extremely committed to support the people with disability. Thank you.
Thank you, Rifat. My name is Sue Swenson. I represent the International Disability Alliance today. I am president of Inclusion International. On behalf of IDA and all of today's sponsors, it is my honor to welcome you to this Global Disability Summit workshop on inclusive education. Please be gentle with us. We're trying to fit what would probably be a week and a half workshop into an hour and a half. We have speakers who have tremendous amounts of knowledge and passion, and we are all trying to stick to our times. Inclusive education gained many commitments at the GDS in 2018. The menu of commitments for GDS 2022 includes strong options for inclusive education. Between 2018 and now, however, the COVID-19 pandemic has thrown a huge challenge at us. And at the same time, it has given us a clearer picture of the reality of our education systems. We see the challenge at a personal level in our own lives and around the world in responses to IDA's COVID-19 survey. We invite you to look at the results of that survey on the IDA website. You will hear today from world experts about what's happening in their countries. We see the challenge at a government level in the Education Finance Report from 2021, which reported that two-thirds of low and lower income countries cut their education budgets since the onset of the pandemic. At the same time, a third of upper, middle, and high income countries reduced their budgets. As the pandemic continues, there is a danger that funding will be cut again and the gap will widen. The pandemic is shining a light on the systemic inequities and barriers that exist in our education systems today for all marginalized students around the world including learners with disabilities. Despite decades of work on inclusive education, in practice, we continue to have two systems of education, one mainstream and one inclusive. We have strong evidence that two systems are not sustainable. The pandemic clarified this truth. Further funding pressure will only make it more salient. Strategies exist. The 2021 UNESCO Global Education Monitoring Report emphasized that education needs to put diversity at its heart, that inclusive education cannot be seen as something associated only with learners with disabilities. IDA agrees. Our global report on inclusive education highlighted that education should be inclusive of all, not just learners with disabilities. The question in front of us then is how to make the shift to inclusive systems everywhere. With GDS 2022, we have an opportunity to create the conditions needed to make inclusive education a reality. IDA calls on all governments, donors, the education center, civil society, the private sector, and organizations of persons with disabilities to join forces to commit to strengthening education systems to be inclusive of all. We invite you now to register and attend the virtual Global Disability Summit 2022. Please join us there. With that, it is now my pleasure to introduce Linda Edim, Senior Director for Development, Global Health, and Humanitarian Response, and Special Assistant to the President of the United States from the National Security Council. Linda, it's your floor.
Thank you, Sue. Good morning, everyone. And thank you also to GCE for hosting this workshop. The importance of elevating disability, inclusive, accessible, and sustainable education couldn't be more pertinent. As Refet and Sue both just pointed out, that the decades-long learning and financing gaps that the global education space was already facing was compounded by the aftershocks of the COVID-19 pandemic, as well as unprecedented levels of conflict and climate change throughout the world. We know that at least 1.6 learners across 190 countries have been impacted, and the World Bank and the United Nations have both estimated that the progress to achieving the 2030 agenda is set back by at least a decade. And the worst part is that we know that the crisis is ongoing. And so learners with disabilities are disproportionately impacted in the three core problem areas that are explicitly called out in the 2030 agenda. The first is the lack of quality disaggregated data that could better inform advocacy efforts, policy decisions, and budget allocations. The second is a lack of investment in school accessibility. And the third is the really critical need to mainstream inclusive education awareness and skills training for both teachers, education systems, and actually for societies at large. The US government strategy on international basic education that was published in 2018 and called for in the bipartisan READ Act seeks to address these challenges by focusing on learning outcomes and expanding the quality of basic education for all, particularly for marginalized and vulnerable populations. As nice as strategies are, however, we all know that it's the action that matters. And so to expand better data and collection, the United States through our lead agency, the U.S. Agency for International Development, is currently partnering on a multi-country study on inclusive education. This study will monitor and evaluate the effectiveness of disability inclusive education activities in Cambodia, Malawi, and Nepal. We need programming like this and studies and evaluations like this to put theories into concrete contexts that are necessary to identify and to mainstream best practices. Next, to expand school accessibility, USAID is supporting the enrollment and retention of children who are blind or low vision in four regions throughout Mali. This is intended to serve as a pilot project that can be scaled throughout the country. Again, learning is really critical, but accessibility is even more important. We're supporting thousands of scholarships right now for university students to train and learn on how they can best accomplish sustainable development goals. And a good proportion of those are students who traditionally would not be represented in these contexts because they have disabilities. we think it's really critical for us to really lean in and think about the accessibility for teachers as well, and to mainstream inclusive education awareness, skills, and training. USAID is investing in education skills for teachers and institutions. One example is the Saraki Foundation in Paraguay. We know that it's launched this really innovative communication strategy called Who Trains Who. This features students who are both disabled with disabilities and those who don't have disabilities, because it's necessary for an inclusive conversation for all to raise this awareness. And so they're calling for inclusive education in sports, in public and private schools, and our public spaces. So again, the advocacy efforts, the training efforts, the investment efforts are all really critical. And, you know, again, these are just a few examples. As you all on the screen know, so much more still needs to be done. The Biden administration is committed to accelerating our work with governments, multi-stakeholder organizations, and other partners to address these persistent gaps in education systems and in mitigating learning loss caused by the COVID-19 pandemic. As President Biden highlighted in the Democracy Summit in December, the United States will work to ensure that the values of diversity, equity, and inclusion are a core tenet of all of our work. And to build back better and to accelerate progress on the 2030 agenda, we have to focus on resilience as the cornerstone of the sector, and the need for equity, especially for women and girls, learners with disabilities, and gender and sexual minorities. The world that we want really depends on this, and we have in our power in the next several years to actually make this into a reality. Thank you.
Great. Hello, everyone. Good morning and good afternoon. My name is Josh Josa. I am from the USAID's Center for Education. I am a disability inclusive education specialist over here. I am so happy to be here today with all of you. And can I just say how exciting it is to see how much demand and momentum for disability inclusive education there is these days? Oh, we have over 150 people here. That's amazing. The Global Disability Summit is prioritizing inclusive education as a key theme. In doing that, we have many other things as well that we are celebrating. Leading up to that, for example, we have more donors and implementing partners than I've ever seen meaningfully working to elevate inclusive education. We have continued advocacy and guidance from organizations with persons with disabilities such as IDA, on what inclusive quality, equitable education means to them. The Biden administration's pronounced commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion and accessibility. USAID's Administrator Power recently spoke at Georgetown University saying, quote, "Each of us has a responsibility to address bigotry and gender discrimination and structural racism and to uphold individual dignity." Our USAID education policy emphasizes this need to focus on the most marginalized populations, including persons with disabilities. In the midst of our collective efforts, we must continue to work closely with persons with disabilities to strive for their, to build their capacity and to bring them into the into decision-making and leadership positions. We should also remember that the findings from the Global Education Monitoring Report, the GEM 2020 report on inclusive education, two points from that report really stick with me. The first being, policymakers, legislators, educators confront delicate and context-specific questions that are related to inclusion. And including children with disabilities in mainstream schools that are not prepared, supported, or accountable for achieving inclusion can intensify experiences of exclusion. The second point, efforts to promote inclusion may inadvertently intensify pressure to conform and reinforce dominant prejudices and intensify minority disadvantage. Those group identities, practices, languages, and beliefs may be devalued, jeopardized, or eradicated, undercutting a sense of belonging. I mention those two pieces because I remember seeing a stark examples of these two points in action when I visited a USAID funded project. The country was pushing for deaf children to be mainstreamed into their local schools with teachers who had only received 10 hours of training in the local sign language. The intent was good, of course, but the planning and execution could have been better. As a result, even though the deaf kids were attending their local schools, these learners were socially isolated from the hearing educators and their peers around them. They lost their right to develop their language and cultural identity with their deaf peers in a sign language rich environment. This had a negative effect. All of this together had a negative effect on their socio-emotional learning and learning outcomes for those deaf children. The Global Disability Summit really underscores the importance of meaningfully engaging with persons with disabilities in development efforts. And the example that I just shared demonstrates the value of working with the communities we intend to serve to be able to identify solutions and ways forward to achieve inclusive education. It's with these two points from the GEM report in mind, along with that North Star of achieving a quality, equitable, and inclusive education for all, that USAID continues working to find practical solutions to bring quality, equitable, and inclusive education for all. USAID's approach to disability inclusive education and what we are learning has a few different factors. First and foremost, we recognize that there is significant diversity among disability, among the disabled community, and that we need to take into consideration this intersectionality. We recognize that certain populations, for example, LGBTQI plus persons, disabled members of ethnic or religious minorities, and women and girls with disabilities, they may face compounding, interconnected, and highly specific barriers and challenges within their daily life. We are learning to better listen to communities of persons with disabilities, particularly those that are not typically at the table, like those with intellectual disabilities, and making sure to involve them in our decision-making processes. With that consideration for intersectionality, our approach to disability inclusion in education and youth workforce development programming is to take a twin track approach. The first track being, we want to capitalize on what we know works well for most children and youth and try to ensure that our broad programming from pre-primary to higher education is accessible and inclusive for children and youth with disabilities. The second track is to make programming investments that specifically target the needs of persons with disabilities, because we do recognize that such approaches are likely required to dismantle the barriers that exist. We consistently strive to tackle more difficult to solve challenges and work with partners to develop practical solutions, because we believe that these will help advance inclusive education programming and improve our lives of people with disabilities all over the world. Some examples of this include incorporating principles of universal design for learning, UDL, for all learners in new USAID education programs. We use these programs as a guide to our approach so that all children and youth can learn more effectively. For example, during the COVID-19 pandemic, countries like Cambodia, Tajikistan, Kenya, and Rwanda drew from this UDL toolkit and pivoted their programming to apply principles of universal design for learning in the development of remote teaching and learning materials. I learned of one story where these materials helped a child with a disability learn alongside their siblings and community members after this was distributed. And what's great is that this wasn't happening before the pandemic because of inaccessible materials, and now it was able to happen. We're continuing to provide USAID staff and partners with the knowledge, skills, and tools to advance and effectively implement disability inclusive education, as well as UDL at all levels of the education continuum. One way we are doing this, interrogating our own programming to learn what works across country contexts to better support the generation and use of new data by doing our partnering on the multi-country study on inclusive education that Linda had mentioned before, previously. Finally, we are improving our own USAID reporting on how we are reaching and benefiting those learners with disabilities from our programming. And meeting with our disability data disaggregation reporting requirements within the education sector. A fun little tidbit is that we've actually seen between funding year 2019 and funding year 2020, we've seen an increase of 131% in disability inclusive education programming at USAID. That is a really big increase within just 1 year. That is just some a sampling of what we are doing within USAID. We really cannot do any of this work alone. Our partners, meaning us all working together, are vital to achieving disability inclusive education. We are fortunate to learn from and through partnerships like the GLAAD Networks Inclusive Education Working Group, where we can share knowledge and work collaboratively. For example, on the second infographic that will be coming out during the global, during the GDS, we'll have a second infographic on inclusive education that will be launching on February 16th. As well as another partnership, All Children Reading a Grand Challenge for Development. It's a partnership between World Vision, USAID and the Australian government. We have many lessons learned from that experience. The Global Disability Summit is a way for all of us in the development community to continue collaborating with each other towards a more strategic integration of principles of UDL and improve socio-emotional and learning outcomes for all learners with disabilities. I dare say it could be used as an accountability tool as well. USAID really looks forward to submitting our commitments by the deadline. We are also fortunate to have coalitions, networks, and communities of practice run like this here, the Global Campaign for Education, mobilize these discussions on inclusive education, such as what we're having here today. So a huge thanks to GCE US and all the partners for hosting this event and your continued advocacy in elevating disability inclusive education and diversity. And thank you.
So thank you.
Thank you very much, Josh and Alexander. Please come in. We heard you begin, but if you're able to come off mute, welcome. Thank you for your patience, colleagues. We will make sure that that our colleague with the Ghana Federation of Disability Organizations is able to rejoin. We know technology can be always a challenge as much as we test it beforehand. And so we'll come right back as soon as he's able to join and go next to our colleague, Penny Innes with the Disability Inclusion Team in the UK. Welcome.
Hi everyone, thank you for the invitation to speak. I am just trying to get my video to show. There we go. Hope you can see me now. I'm Penny Innes, the head of the Disability Inclusion Team at the Foreign, Commonwealth and Development Office in the UK. I'm so excited that the second Global Disability Summit is less than a month away. I was in the lead on organising the first Global Disability Summit, which I think was the highlight of my career so far. And I'm really proud of the team, but all of our partners who helped us to bring it into being and that it's living on as well. I was reflecting the other day about the summit and the fantastic leadership that was shown by people with disabilities at the summit. And particularly it came to mind two people with intellectual disabilities, Mia Farah and Mark Mpemba, who co-chaired the plenary and did a brilliant job. Our overriding aim was always for the summit to create change for people with disabilities. And it seems as though the Norway summit is really galvanizing action. We're hearing of organizations working on announcements for the summit, organizations making new commitments and developing strategies, and organizations, new organizations making ambitious commitments for the first time. And this is important because, as we've heard so well so far, the need is great and sadly getting worse, including in education. So even before the pandemic, around 50% of children with disabilities were not in school. And we know that COVID-19 has led to even more inequality, with many children with disabilities unable to get to school or have the facilities to learn at home. In 2018, the UK made 17 commitments at the Global Disability Summit, some of which were very ambitious indeed. And we have made a lot of progress and have found the GDS Secretariat monitoring reports really helpful in having an opportunity to prompt information on progress from colleagues across the Foreign, Commonwealth and Development Office. So next month's summit is also an amazing opportunity to seek new ambition. And we're gathering our commitments right now, both specific commitments for action on disability, but also more mainstreaming kind of commitments on issues such as engaging with organisations of people with disabilities, on data, and on promoting the voice of people with disabilities. Looking at education specifically, we are committed to ensuring that every child can realise their right to education, including girls and including children with disabilities. We have a strong commitment to stand up for the rights of every girl to receive 12 years of quality education. And in particular, by 2026, we will help 40 million more girls into school, to attend school, and support 20 million more girls to be able to read by the age of 10 or at the end of primary school. We recognise we cannot achieve these ambitious goals without reaching children with disabilities. And the UK Prime Minister launched our Girls Education Action Plan last year, and this sets out practical steps that we will take. We invest in quality teaching for all. We aim to transform education systems to drive learning outcomes at scale. We will eliminate barriers that face marginalised girls, including those with diverse disabilities, to help them access education from early childhood through to their transition to adulthood. So how do we do this? Through increasing the visibility of children with disabilities by collecting better disaggregated data and generating new evidence. Secondly, we will give children with disabilities in humanitarian crises an equitable opportunity to learn in safe, inclusive environments. And our programmes will tackle the barriers that children with disabilities, especially girls, face in going to school and learning. So to conclude, I really want to encourage everyone in the education community to use the Global Disability Summit. This is an opportunity that doesn't come very often, We have less than a month now. So we need to use it wisely so that we collectively commit to some ambitious new action to support children with disabilities who badly need our support. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And we're grateful that Alexander Williams has been able to rejoin through Zoom. We're delighted that Ghana and Norway are co-chairing the 2022 Global Disability Summit. And we're grateful to the UK, everybody that has made this important work possible, building off of the summit in 2018. Alexander, are you able to come in?
Yeah, okay, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And sorry for that. Good afternoon, good morning, and depending on who you are once again. Thanks for the brief introduction. So I was trying to introduce myself earlier on. I'm Alexander Bankole Williams, chairman of the National Advocacy Committee of the Ghana Federation of Disability Organizations. And as has been indicated earlier on, Ghana will be co-hosting this year's GDS. And I'm trying to share my screen here. Do I have to do that?
No, but please just go ahead. We have your slides up for you now. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. Great. So by way of inclusive education in Ghana, in relation to some relevant background on the education of persons with disabilities, we generally have in excess of about 128,000 persons with disabilities, that is children with disabilities between the ages of 6 and 14 years. Sorry, just a moment. Between the ages of 6 and 14 years, who are supposed to be children within the school going age bracket, but of this number, you have in excess of 16,200 actually not in school. When you look at the 2010 integrated public use microdata series, it also puts the population of children with disabilities or youth with disabilities between the ages of 15 and 29. And this age bracket actually constitutes 2.1% of Ghana's population. Now you do have on average about 83% of persons with disabilities attending school, with 74% of persons with disabilities actually attending school. And this brings the disability parity index of about 0.9%. And with regards at individuals being in school in relation to disability. Now, when you look at the policy and legislative framework that has guided Ghana's actions on inclusive education so far, you have Ghana being a signatory to a couple of international conventions and treaties. And these include the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the Convention Against Discrimination in Education, and then we have the Convention on the Rights of the Child, and then a Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, the CRPD, which Ghana ratified it in 2012. Now, Ghana, as a result of all these relevant commitments, has built a relevant inclusive education policy. Just a moment, sorry. In May 2016, Ghana actually launched its inclusive education policy to respond to the the diverse learning needs of learners with disabilities, as well as in compliance with Article 25 of his 1992 Constitution that speaks to the right to accessing quality education by all manner of persons. Now, in view of this, since 2016, Ghana has actually sought to implement its inclusive education policy in selected districts across the country. In total of 7 districts have tried to implement fully the inclusive education policy so far, and it's come up with a few achievements. Some of the achievements that the inclusive education implementation has actually brought up includes one, the fact that children with disabilities have been afforded opportunities to attend schools in their respective communities. And this is against the practice of the special school systems where you had children with disabilities, especially needing to travel hundreds of kilometers across the country to actually get into one school or the other. And the downside of that was that parents who could not afford to actually kept their children at home. And this was in a lot of cases. Additionally, this has the implementation of the inclusive education policy in Ghana has also helped in increasing awareness on issues of disability and living with persons with disabilities as well, on the part of both teachers as well as learners. So you do have teachers who hitherto the implementation of the policy who did not particularly pay attention to issues of disability or children with special needs in the classroom. And the implementation of the policy has come to adjust the teachers' behaviors and the teachers' learning and teachers' attitude towards these matters to consider the diverse needs of all the learners in the classroom. And on the other hand, we also have the students or learners without disability who have also had the peer-to-peer direct education from their peers with disabilities as to how to live with an individual with disabilities and accepting them as one of them. The implementation of the inclusive education policy in Ghana has also led to an increment in the enrollment of learners with disabilities across the country. And we generally find this as a highly positive initiative of the government of Ghana to ensure that they are promoting the participation of persons with disabilities in mainstream society, including ensuring their basic rights to accessing education. We feel that generally the inclusive education system is serving as a learning point for the entire continent in Africa, especially on the basis of the acceptability of persons with disabilities within mainstream society. Having said all these, there have been some challenges that we can easily point out in relation to the implementation of inclusive education in Ghana. We realize that there is a high deficit in the skill of teachers who have to handle students with disabilities or learners with disabilities to fully participate in the learning system. So, as a result, you have the situation where in some cases, there are certain subjects that these teachers still exclude the students from learning. We also find the situation of a high deficit in the accessible teaching and learning materials for learners with disabilities, as well as the teachers themselves who deploy the inclusive education policy. Now, this is partly due to the fact that the relevant teaching and learning materials are also not produced in these countries. One of the related challenges to what I just discussed is the limited capacity of the relevant social actors to accommodate those with special needs. We also find that there is still low awareness among parents of children with disabilities as to, first and foremost, the right of the child with disability to education, and furthermore, the provisions that are currently made within our policy framework to ensure that these children are actually brought on board. In fact, as per the laws of Ghana currently, it is actually criminal not to enroll your child with disability in an education institution if that individual ought to be in school. Now, we realize another factor to the low enrollment of these children has to do with the limited resources that the government of Ghana actually commits to the implementation of inclusive education. So when you look at a critical example in the 2018 GDS, the government of Ghana actually committed to ensuring that it was going to allocate 1.5% of the Ministry of Education's budget to inclusive education. But our checks in the 2019-2020 budget actually revealed that what the government of Ghana had actually allocated to inclusive education, which included special education, was 0.3% of our annual budget for the Ministry of Education. It is therefore not surprising that we have the current challenge we have in relation to the deficit in resources. In conclusion, in 2019, the Federation conducted some survey in some selected districts, and it was revealed in those few districts that in excess of about 1,950 plus children with disabilities were actually out of school. And this was done in actually 10 districts. We are hoping that all relevant stakeholders in Ghana and beyond will commit significantly to the implementation of inclusive education in consonance with the provisions in Article 24 of the CRPD and all other relevant legislations to ensure that the rights of children with disabilities are upheld in relation to education, and also the fact that we use education as a means of a significant participation opportunity for children with disabilities in mainstream society. We therefore call upon all stakeholders to ensure that by virtue of our participation in the upcoming GDS and beyond, we ensure that we prioritize the implementation of inclusive education in our respective countries. Thank you for the opportunity.
Hi to everybody. My name is Margaret Matonya. I'm a director of Special Need Education. I'm working at the Ministry of Education, Science and Technology. First of all, I want to say thank you so much for being part of the Global Disability Committee to discuss the status of inclusive education in different countries, in different areas in the world. So first of all, I will start with the definition of inclusive education in Tanzania. It was very complex, and most of the people, when they hear about inclusive education, they were totally thinking about disability or people with disabilities. Nowadays, due to awareness creation and conducting different seminars and workshops. Most of teachers and the parents and the communities now, somehow they are aware about what we mean when we say inclusive education. Inclusive education in Tanzania, we started in 1997 as a pilot in four areas. And then after assessing the workability of the pilot, we scaled up the whole country to make sure that every regions and every schools, they are working on inclusive education. So we have a lot of milestone we reached in Tanzania. First of all, since 2008, we started to have a national strategy for inclusive education. The first one was started on 2008 until 2018. These are the first strategy in Tanzania with emphasis on including all children in education without leaving someone behind. And also we prepared the second strategy for 2018 to 2021. So we phased out last year, and now we have a new strategy for 2021 to 2026. We already signed, and then we are expecting to launch 28th of January, which means next week, Thursday. So what are the differences of this strategy? The first strategy, they were just based on basic education. It means that pre-primary, primary, and secondary education. But current, this new strategy, we are looking inclusive education in a wider perspective, which means that from pre-primary to higher education, without leaving some, without leaving one or two levels, no one can leave, no one can leave behind. So we have prepared for 5 years strategy, and with the focus on making sure that all children they are getting the support based of their diverse needs. So this new strategy is focusing on a pre-primer, primer, secondary, teachers college, vocational, adult education, focal development colleges, and higher education. So this strategy is working like a tool which can help us to implement this inclusive education in a system of how it can work. So the other milestone where we worked on Tanzania is to make sure that we are training a lot of teachers. We trained a lot of teachers, more than 1,000, on how to handle the inclusive classroom when they have a kids in a classroom with either ill or they have different kind of disabilities, how the teachers they are handling their learning. And also based on this training, also we trained the school quality assurer on how to assess the inclusive classrooms. As we know that the school quality assurance in Tanzania, they are working on assessing the school, the learning, teaching and the learning process in a classroom. Also, they are assessing the construction, if the construction is cuts the needs of the whole learners with the special needs. And also this quality assurer, they are assessing the pedagogy approach of the teachers. So we realize that if we want to have effective and appropriate inclusive education, we needed to train the school quality assurer to make sure that the learning and teaching process, they are meeting the diverse learning of of the student and also the construction they are constructing. They are meeting the diverse needs of the learners and also the pedagogy they are using. So the other thing, the Tanzania, what is to have this sign language dictionary, Tanzanian sign language dictionary for the deaf student. As we know before, we didn't have this Tanzanian sign language. So it was hard for the communication and also for the understanding, because the teachers, they came from different countries or different areas with different knowledge. So sometimes the student, they get confusion when they are teaching or when they are in primary school. And then when they go to the secondary school, they are getting confusion about the signing of the words of the language. So now we have a Dicto Tanzanian dictionary, and we already distributed to secondary schools. And then we are waiting to distribute it to primary schools and pre-primary, because it is a digital, we are supposed to put on the tablet, and then the students, they are accessing on the tablet. And based on the construction, the old infrastructure, majority were rehabilitated. And also we decided to prepare the construction strategy for 2020 in order to guide the old construction to have accessible and appropriate to meet the diverse needs of the learners with a special education. We, because of this free education, as we know since 2015, all this basic education from pre-primary to secondary, children, they are not paying school fees. So this situation caused a lot of children with special needs to come to school to access and participate in the schools. So based on this number of children also, we are providing, Tanzania is, we are providing teaching and learning materials and assistive device based on the needs of the students to make sure that they are accessing and they are participating in the learning process. And also we have a different guidelines for students with the special needs. We prepare the supervision and management of special and inclusive schools. And within that document, we put what kind of assistive device the children with special needs they need, what are the construction buildings, and what are the laws of every stakeholders in order to make sure that this student they are attending schools. Other things we did is training. We prepared a training manual, inclusive training manual, because we realized that every international organization, they have their own teaching and learning training manual for inclusive education. And so we compiled and we came with one document, which we are calling training manual for inclusive education, to make sure that the whole country, we are getting the same content, and also we are getting the same pedagogy. Not only that, also we went to VETA, vocational education. There we already prepared the policy for inclusive education to guide how the VETAs can assist the children with special needs. And also we prepared the training manual for the teachers who are teaching in a vocational education, because we realized that these teachers, they have a content, but what they are missing, it is just a pedagogy on how to handle the inclusive classrooms. So we already prepared the training manual, pedagogy training manual for inclusive education to make sure that even the betas, they are becoming inclusive. Also in higher education, we have 12 higher education, which is inclusive higher education. So in higher education, we prepared the policy for higher education and the guidelines how the higher education can support children with inclusive education. And also we distributed the teaching and learning materials and also assistive device based on category of needs for the kids, for the children with the special needs. And also in terms of adult education, also we went to adult education. We are working with the adult education to make sure that adult education also it is inclusive. We have three programs in adult education. We have IPOSA is running with UNICEF. And also we have COBET, Complementary Basic Education. And we have integrated community-based education. This integrated based community education is just helping those children with special needs who want to go for getting some knowledge and then going back to the field and working, for example, how to make soap, how to make clothes like batiki, or how to make chokes. So they are going there for 3 months and then they are getting skills and then they are getting back to community. So in terms of inclusive education, current, we see the future of inclusive education because we have covered from pre-primary to higher education. It means that to all levels of education. Apart from supporting this teaching and learning assistive device, and also we have guidelines for home visits in order to strengthen parent teachers partnership. We have every week the teachers, they are going once to visit the children with special needs at homes. So we have prepared the guidelines how the teachers they can go to the field and how they can meet with the parents and what are the issues they are supposed to take into consideration when they go to visit the children at school. And also we have a draft for homeschooling guidelines. We realize that we have our children because of their sickness or because of their disability, they are not able to stay at a school. So we have teachers whom they are going to teach them at home. They are teaching them either they are giving them regular subjects, or they are giving them some life skills to make sure that they are feeling better and then they feel involved in terms of the inclusive education.
I'm so sorry, Dr. Matonia. It sounds like you're doing such amazing work, and thank you. Please share if you can. Questions have come in the Q&A box and chat box. We only have a few minutes to finish the workshop. Like Sue said earlier, there's so much amazing work happening. So let's continue to share. Thank you so much for all that you're leading, and please continue to share with the global community the amazing work that you're doing. Thank you very much.
Maybe I can mention one challenges. It's just the attitudes for the parents and teachers, and also lack of teachers, and also lack of assistive device. Thank you so much.
Hi, thanks everyone. Well, I hope, thanks first of all for the patience with the listening to the amazing work that has been done in the different contexts, from refugee driven context to development context. Well, I'm Alexandra Mate, as the screen says, and I'm the World Vision Syria Response Advocacy and Communications Director, overseeing the work in Turkey, Jordan and Syria for the organization, but also equally important, I'm the co-chair of the Knowledge Generation Initiative, which is an advocacy initiative that we're co-chairing and driving with UNICEF colleagues across the five countries. Jordan is one of them. The reason for which I am here today is literally to dive into the context of Jordan. Knowing that we don't have too much, I do encourage you to register as soon as you get the invite to our side event in the framework of the GDS next month, where we will be presenting the full range of survey findings and interview findings that we have carried out in Jordan, both with teachers, with parents who are sending their children to children with disabilities to school, but also the ones who are more reluctant in sending them to school. And the findings are quite amazing, and they really speak to all of the great work that you are doing and many things that are very common across our context. As some of you might know or might not know, but my peer panelist at the very beginning has very well said, refugee children are really bearing the cost of wars in their own in their own countries of origin, but most importantly in the host country. Although Jordan has been doing quite really well, I have to say, even before the pandemic, in what concerns enrollment to education, which was, I think, 87% at that time, the enrollment rate. However, the learning and the quality of education has lagged behind. And I think that's similar for all of us in the different contexts where we are. But children with disabilities within this, let's say, forced displaced vulnerability group are definitely way more affected, whether we're talking about access to remote learning, whether we're talking about the type of specialized learning content that they need. I think they are the ones who are lacking behind. And it's great to have all of these amazing minds here who can really push this agenda forward. And that's what we need in the coming year. So just to be very short, we have some preliminary findings that I'm happy to share with you, but they speak to three main points, I think. The first point that they speak to, and that was something that came quite interesting to us as well, is the fact that the parents, for example, who are sending their children to school are more likely to have children that have, children with like a certain type of hearing or speech disability, while the others who are not sending their children to school, whether we're talking about refugee children, but also the affected Jordanian community, are actually the ones who have, let's say, an intellectual or learning disability. And this came quite as an interesting finding or a behavioral finding to us while we were conducting the survey. And also it was in a way triangulated this finding with what the teachers have told us in the different focus groups, saying that it's always sort of harder or maybe more difficult to integrate the children that have a certain intellectual or learning disability, into the classroom, both in the short term, but also in the long term. So I think that's something quite interesting that we as, aid actors in the field might not have been aware before. And that's the uniqueness of this methodology, behavioral barrier analysis methodology that World Vision has developed for 15 years almost now. But going to the second sort of finding that I want to share with you so that you get to read our full report is that we understood that the parents who are actually sending their children to school are almost three times more likely to have in their support groups other parents who have children with disabilities. And that's something simple that's coming to us into sort of a support network activation or even psychological support angle, but it was also coming a little bit of a surprise when we started integrating and starting adding up the two things. And on the other hand, you know, the parents whose children have disabilities but were not sending their children to school were actually twice more likely to say they didn't know anyone. That speaks quite highly to the fact that we do need to invest in the support groups of this in our programs. And this is maybe one element that is not so much spoken about or addressed. But even more so interestingly is that, you know, the let's say what we call them doers in the report, and you'll get to read that, but the parents who are sending their children to school are actually three times more likely to have a positive outlook on their children's future, thinking they can really finish education and they can really build up a future for themselves. And hope we've seen across our CRI response programs is a critical, critical and essential element to the success of our programs. And that's also something that's always missing. So we're seeing that in Jordan as well, with both Jordanians and non-Jordanians family or refugee families, where, you know, the parents whose children have a certain disability and do not send their children to school are actually almost eight times more likely to disagree with the fact that their children will be able to have a successful life. And I think that's a little bit mind-blowing for us, because these are elements of the behavior that we were not aware of. And I think it was mentioned in the in this rich discussion that there is a discrepancy between the different genders, between female and male. And I think that is definitely the case, because, for example, in Middle Eastern cultures, well, whether you're looking at Jordanian cultures or Syrian cultures, the boy really is the central piece in terms of the family lineage and heritage and strength. So I think that according to us and the teachers we've spoken with, many fathers had actually troubles coming to the terms with the fact that the child, that their male children have some sort of disability and they cannot necessarily, you know, lead on the lineage or support the family. So I think there is sort of a psychosocial element that I always say needs to be integrated in all of our disability inclusion and education for these children who have been in the case of Syria, displaced for 11 years. I think in a couple of weeks, we are marking the 11-year crisis. So I do want to sort of leave you with all of this rich information without taking too much of your time, and do encourage you to join us for the side event at the GDS, because I think there is much more information we're going to get in the next days that we would love to share with you. Thank you so much.
Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everyone. It's really excellent to be able to join this event today. My name is Charlotte McLean-Nhlapo, and I am the Global Disability Advisor at the World Bank Group. It truly is an honor to be amongst such a committed group of organizations and individuals dedicated to making disability inclusive education a reality across the globe. As many of you know, during the first Global Disability Summit, the World Bank made 10 commitments on disability inclusive development. The first of those commitments builds on the objectives of the Sustainable Development Goals, number 4, by ensuring that all World Bank financed education programs and projects are disability inclusive by 2025. Today, I want to provide you a brief update on some of the activities the bank has taken to achieve this commitment and make children with disabilities, enable children with disabilities to access an education across the world. As the bank works to operationalize disability inclusive education into all of its new projects, we are guided by two key principles. the Universal Design for Learning, which has been mentioned by some earlier speakers, and the twin track approach. The bank's approach to education focuses on inclusion writ large, including disability inclusion, and recognizes that the cross-cutting nature of inclusion requires us to bake it into our projects and move away from seeing inclusion as an add-on issue. To support the operationalization of this approach, last April, the World Bank's Education Global Practice launched a guidance note. The note presents four criteria to disability inclusive education for project design, implementation, and monitoring. These four criteria include stakeholder engagement, analysis, inclusive project design, and monitoring and reporting. They emphasize the importance of collecting disability disaggregated data and using disability focused indicators in project results framework. The note also sets out the twin track approach to disability inclusive education, which recognizes two distinct pathways to supporting learners with disabilities. The first track by mainstreaming education, and the second track by targeting learners with disabilities. The guidance note is accompanied by an inclusive education resource guide, which provides a more comprehensive menu of project design activities, including actual World Bank projects as case studies on inclusive education. These resources aim to support task teams and country offices in meeting the bank's commitment to have all investment project financing disability inclusive by 2025. And while these resources were developed for bank staff, we recognize that they can be used beyond the bank, and so we will share them in the chat box. In addition to the resources developed, the Global Practice on Social Sustainability and Inclusion manages two trust funds focused on operationalizing disability inclusive education in low-income country contexts, including in sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia. The two trust funds are the Inclusive Education Initiative and the Disability Inclusive Education in Africa program. And allow me a quick word on both. The Inclusive Education Initiative is a multi-donor trust fund overseen by the World Bank with support from NORAD and FCDO. It invests in catalytic technical expertise and knowledge and resources that support countries in making education progressively inclusive for children across the spectrum of disability. The IEI has three pillars. The first pillar focuses on in-country intervention, and this includes investing in systems that strengthen inclusive education. And we have the focus of three countries, Nepal, Ethiopia, and Rwanda. Over $3.5 million in funds have been committed and disbursed to these countries. Allow me just briefly to share snippets from these projects. In Nepal, we have launched three low-cost mobile apps to teach sign language and math for kids with hearing and visual disabilities. In Ethiopia, we have facilitated a partnership with Ethiopia's Ministry of Education to strengthen its education management information system and base policy making on quality data on disability. In Rwanda, the bank's Inclusive Education Thematic Group is implementing Rwanda's Inclusive Education Policy Academy, which includes a series of online and hybrid learning activities to support policymakers and build their capacity to design and implement disability inclusive interventions. It integrates peer-to-peer support with interactive virtual workshops related to various themes, including inclusive data and IMIS, inclusive teacher education and training, accessible curricula, teaching and learning materials, and educational technologies. Through these projects, the World Bank seeks to support the development of systemic change that strengthens education systems and equips local change makers with cutting-edge knowledge and practical relevant skills to ensure implementation and to drive policy change where necessary. The second pillar focuses on global public goods. This pillar supports partners in developing research, evidence, and resources to to operationalize inclusive education. I want to highlight a few of the many global public goods that have been produced under the IEI. So at the onset of the pandemic, we developed a just-in-time issues paper called Pivoting to Inclusion, Leveraging Lessons from COVID-19 Crisis for Learners with Disabilities. This paper has since been reinforced by a survey report titled Learners with Disabilities and COVID-19 School Closures. The survey explores data collected from a global survey we conducted to better understand the experiences of learners with disabilities during the initial months of the pandemic and the related school closures. Links to these resources will be shared. Last year, we also hosted a series of research exchange workshops. And to those, we invited scholars virtually from sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia. This exchange provided a unique platform for researchers from the Global South to identify their own research priorities and discuss the challenges they experience in conducting research and publishing their own work on disability inclusive education. We have published several of these research blogs, and we have a blog platform called Words for Inclusion, which is hosted on the accessible IEI website, and I would encourage you all to visit the website. We also have a vibrant community of practice with now over 2,500 members. And on this platform, we share reports, blog posts, upcoming events, and this is all focused on disability inclusive education. Again, I welcome you all to join. I also want to take this opportunity to invite you to the upcoming launch of the ICT landscape review we conducted, which looks at how ICT has the potential to improve learning outcomes of children with disabilities. This launch will take place on February the 7th. Information will be shared in the chat box. The third and final pillar of the IEI is a pillar on innovation funding. Under this pillar, we have invested in testing and scaling innovative interventions that address the complex challenges of inclusive education. More concretely, we have awarded 11 grants focusing on inclusive teaching practices, the social determinants of inclusive education, and inclusive learning assessments. Allow me to share with you some examples of one of the innovative grants that we awarded to the bank team in Indonesia. This grant will support a program for online disability identification and continuous learning support for children with disabilities. And we do look forward to learning more from this grant. The second trust fund I mentioned is the Disability Inclusive Education in Africa program, which is funded by USAID. This program provides financing to the World Bank to execute activities and projects along with analytical work. For this project, we have a series of small grants and activities that have made significant impact across 7 countries in sub-Saharan Africa. These activities include evidence-based teaching and training, capacity building modules, strengthening education management information systems, assessing different modalities of supporting inclusive education, developing new screening tools, and raising awareness amongst parents and the communities. Under this trust fund, a diagnostic study is underway in sub-Saharan Africa on the key determinants, barriers, and facilitators to educational participation and outcomes for children with disabilities. The diagnostic will feature case studies from Rwanda, Sierra Leone, and Zambia. We will gladly share the findings once completed in the next coming months. In closing, I want to remind us all that disability inclusive education is still very much an emerging sector. Many governments and organizations have demonstrated strong commitment to the agenda. However, continued support and building capacity are essential to ensure systems change. It must be said that resources, expertise, and time are essential to embedding disability inclusive principles into the education service delivery system. We are encouraged by some of the significant achievements made, but we're also very mindful that there's still much more to do. We are energized to know that you're all right beside us as we work towards ensuring a more inclusive and accessible education system for children with disabilities across the world. And with that, I would like to thank you. And I now hand the floor to Kansa Maria, a student from Pakistan.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me?
Oh, great. Yes.
Great, thank you. So my name is Kansa and I'm currently doing an MPhil in Development Studies at Oxford University. I'm originally from Pakistan, and before I proceed further, I want to give a small audio description of what I am doing and where I am at for any blind people watching this. So I'm a brown woman, I'm wearing a beige hijab and a beige jacket, which is sleeveless, and a black shirt. I think behind me, you can see doors and walls, basically. I'm currently sitting in the heart of Oxford. And if someone had told me 10 years ago that I'd be sitting here talking to you guys on a Zoom call, I probably would not have believed you, because at that point, getting an education was hard enough, let alone dreaming about Oxford and dreaming about presenting at this summit. I'm here to tell you the story of how inclusive education works in the global South, even when we don't have many laws or policies supporting education, which is inclusive. To begin with the beginning of my story, my mother had two blind kids. And suffice to say, nobody had expected it. Nobody knew how to deal with it, let alone educate them. Many people had different ideas. Some wanted her to send her kids to special schools. Others wanted her to send her kids to, you know, an orphanage or something, because disability is perceived as a taboo or a stigma. And people don't think about education or integration. The idea is to keep them separate so that they don't sort of infect anyone else with the same disability. However, she did interact with a global organization, which is Sightsavers, and the doctor there told her to educate her children in mainstream schools. From that day onwards, she was on a mission. And the mission was to educate her children in mainstream schools. Despite schools telling her that they were not equipped to deal with these children, and despite those around her telling her that they would not admit her children in mainstream schools and think about special schools, she began her search of finding schools that would admit her children who were both blind. And so my brother and I started our journey in mainstream schools. These schools didn't necessarily do anything special or provide any accommodations or any accessibility support for my brother and I. And yet we studied there. We were reliant on our mother to read books to us. We were reliant on friends to have study sessions for us, because people hadn't necessarily heard of technology that would bridge these gaps. And I was in grade 6 when I finally heard an audiobook. And an entire world of Harry Potter, of Charlie and the Chocolate Factory opened up to me. And this world wasn't necessarily reliant on my mom to take time away from her housekeeping duties and also her job to read to me and to teach me. Even though I had glimpsed this world of accessible technology, I did not necessarily have access to this expensive technology. No one around me used it, and no one around me knew how to use it, even when they were able to purchase it. Suffice to say, we persisted. I listened to my lectures, listened to my family read out to me, and was able to get admitted into a good university abroad, Georgetown. And after I got into Georgetown, I got access to all this technology in the form of accessible books, which were read by screen readers, and these things which opened a new world to me, like a braille display. And I began to use this technology independently. I realized that I could join things like Zoom meetings, but I could also stalk my friends on Facebook. And I could also do things like writing blogs and writing, you know, any stories that I wanted to. An entire community of online friends opened up to me. And these were people living in different continents who were also blind, but were accomplishing amazing things. So that's how I found community and friends, but I also found independence, which is why I'm here to tell you about the practical implications of inclusive education. I want to tell you that it's not really as expensive as people perceive it to be. All you need is teachers who are willing to adapt, parents who are willing to accommodate, and friends who are willing to bridge these gaps. And I'm not telling you that it's easy to bridge these gaps or to make education inclusive, but I'm telling you that it's worth trying and it's worth finding your own solutions for these problems, because technology is available to bridge these gaps, but sometimes solutions are as easy as you listening to your friends as they revise for their own classes. And obviously it's beneficial for them as well, because let's face it, they're reading stuff that they wouldn't ordinarily read or revise for themselves. You might illustrate or explain a concept. The world of technology has opened many doors. You can read tactile graphs. You can read tactile braille books in a second if you hook them up to your computer, which is things that you couldn't do, you know, earlier. And so inclusive education today is a lot easier than it was in the past or when I started. But I want you to think about three things as you move into the Global Disability Summit and as you design your policies and your solutions. The first and most important thing is for you to listen to the voices of people with disabilities around you. People who are impacted by these choices that you make. Think about how an inclusive school will work on a grassroots level, as opposed to just designing large plans and creating documents. Talk to people, get their input. My second recommendation is to think about bridging technological gaps and providing people with access to technology, but also thinking about training. So you can give all the blind people in this world free braille displays, but you also need to think about how those braille displays will be used and the practical applications of these things. So giving access to technology without teaching teachers and students how to use it is really pointless. So give them access to this technology and teach them how to use it. Teach them how they can use it on an everyday basis on things more than education, things like internships and extracurricular opportunities, which brings me on to my last point. Think about education as more than creating an inclusive classroom. If your students want to be debaters, football players, or participate in the drama club, how do you make these things? How do you think about making your students a part of these opportunities? How do you think about diversity in your internships, in your school grants, or your SATs or ACTs? So basically, think about everything else that gives an education, things which are more than books and more than reading math sums. So I guess my last point here is for people to think about stories like mine as more than just exceptions. I'm here to share one story of a girl who made it from Pakistan to Oxford, but the struggle that we have in front of us is a lot longer. We need to work for a day where stories like mine stop being an exception and become a part of the general story of students everywhere going to school, thinking about universities, or thinking about vocational education.
Buenos días. Buenos días, soy Jaime Cruz, autogestor en Perú y parte del equipo de autogestores empowerados de inclusión internacional. Gracias por invitarme a participar en este taller. Para mí, la educación inclusiva para personas con discapacidad intelectual significa que nosotros también podemos y debemos estudiar con los otros estudiantes en un mismo colegio. Mi visión sobre la educación inclusiva es que sea natural, que todos los estudiantes y estudiantes estemos juntos, que se entienda que todas las personas somos diferentes y que las personas con discapacidad no nos parecemos unas a otras, que se respeten nuestros tiempos sin apresurarnos y que se trabaje con un material que sea fácil para entender, que sirva a todos los estudiantes. Pero todo esto cambió. No puede ser de unas cuantas escuelas. Por eso es importante que los gobiernos y los ministros de educación se comprometan y crean en la educación inclusiva. Solo así ellos van a hablar con sus equipos para hacer los cambios necesarios. Por ejemplo, que todos los profesores se capaciten y puedan enseñar. También y las personas con discapacidad intelectual, que no nos discriminen y podemos estar en cualquier colegio. O para que preparen material en lenguaje sencillo y lectura fácil, porque la inclusión no solo es rampas, ascensores, sistema de braille y lenguajes de señas, es cambiar de actitud. Estar incluido puede ayudar a cambiar la forma de pensar de las personas sin discapacidad. Por ejemplo, cuando yo estaba en el colegio, el padre de una compañera pensaba que una persona con síndrome Down no podía hacer cosas ni aprender en el colegio. Pero luego, cuando me conoció, cambió su manera de pensar. Se dio cuenta que yo era una persona como cualquiera. La educación inclusiva también es buena, porque los otros estudiantes aprenden y tratan a la persona con discapacidad con respeto y tolerancia. Cuando nunca han tratado a una persona con discapacidad intelectual, tienen miedo a lo desconocido. En la época que yo estudié, la inclusión no era muy común. No había muchos colegios inclusivos y era muy difícil para los padres conseguir que nos matriculen, porque siempre respondían que los profesores no estaban preparados. Todavía escuchamos esas respuestas, pero cada vez hay más inclusión. Mis padres consiguieron un colegio inclusivo y el apoyo de una organización que ayudaba a hacer adaptaciones curriculares, las sensibilizaciones, las charlas para los profesores y padres. Y así todos aprendimos juntos. Pero eso les costaba dinero a mis padres. Creo que otra cosa que ayudó en mi inclusión es que también participaba en diferentes actividades en el colegio, fuera del salón, como el deporte. Mis compañeros podían ver que yo sabía nadar bien, jugar básquet, correr, y participábamos en las mismas actividades. Yo aún me reúno con mis compañeros. Un problema todavía en mi país es que las personas con discapacidad intelectual que terminan la secundaria no pueden seguir estudiando como sus otros compañeros porque es más difícil y no hay apoyos. Y eso hace que estemos menos preparados para trabajar. Lo que yo quiero para mi futuro es vivir independiente, solo con un amigo o mi pareja. Me estoy preparando para eso y ser un excelente actor. Trabajar para poder pagar mis gastos y no depender de mis padres. Quiero que haya cada vez más, más oportunidades, más inclusión y que se respete nuestros derechos. Muchas gracias.
Bonjour à tous et toutes. Je suis Ernestine Gomilha, fondatrice et directrice et exécutive de l'Association d'aide à l'éducation de l'enfant handicapé. Je suis très heureuse de participer à cet atelier aujourd'hui pour bâtir des recommandations et des appels pour une éducation inclusive. Donc, l'organisation que je représente est une association qui a pour mission de promouvoir l'éducation pour tous, de promouvoir l'autonomisation des personnes handicapées par le biais de l'éducation avec un focus sur les filles en situation de handicap et aussi l'organisation mène des recherches sur les questions de handicap pour atteindre, réaliser ses missions. Elle a besoin de travailler en partenariat avec d'autres structures pour avoir un impact assez élevé. Donc aujourd'hui, mon propos va être articulé sur deux points pour lancer justement un appel à agir pour une éducation inclusive, attentive aux leçons tirées de la COVID-19 et respectueuse du genre. En 2020, nous avons été confrontés à une crise sanitaire sans précédent qui a conduit à la fermeture des écoles et à imaginer de nouvelles façons de permettre aux élèves de continuer d'apprendre. Donc, au cours du premier mois, en mars et avril, nous avons été sollicités assez souvent par les parents d'enfants en situation de handicap pour demander des conseils, pour avoir des informations. Et ce qui nous a amené à faire une enquête, à lancer une enquête pour savoir comment les élèves en situation de handicap, quelle est l'expérience des élèves en situation de handicap pendant cette période. Puisque dans la plupart des pays, il y avait des mesures qui avaient été prises pour assurer la continuité pédagogique. Et donc, dans le cadre de cette enquête, nous nous sommes intéressés à trois questions principales. La première, c'était de savoir quelles mesures avaient été mises en place dans différents pays. La deuxième, c'était quelles difficultés étaient confrontés les élèves en situation de handicap ou les personnes qui sont censées assurer leur continuité pédagogique pour les accompagner. Et le troisième point, c'était les suggestions de recommandations pendant la période de confinement, donc de l'enseignement à distance et au-delà de la période de crise sanitaire pour pouvoir améliorer ou proposer des recommandations en vue de l'amélioration des systèmes d'éducation ou des politiques éducatives. Donc, les résultats principaux auxquels nous sommes arrivés sont de deux ordres. Et le constat, c'est que la scolarisation des enfants handicapés est à l'épreuve de la crise sanitaire. Le deuxième constat, c'est qu'il y a eu des réelles difficultés pour assurer la continuité des apprentissages aux élèves handicapés, quand bien même des mesures auraient été mises en place. Ce qui nous est revenu, par exemple, c'est que concernant les enfants malentendants, les interprétations des cours dispensés via la télévision n'étaient pas assez fidèles et les parents avaient aussi des difficultés à suivre leurs enfants parce qu'ils n'avaient pas des capacités à le faire. Il faut souligner que ce qui nous a frappé dans le retour de notre questionnaire, c'est que la plupart des personnes qui ont répondu sont des parents d'enfants handicapés et des parents dont les enfants ont des handicaps sensoriels et notamment des enfants qui ont des problèmes auditifs. Et la deuxième chose qui nous a frappé, certes, l'enquête était en français, c'était une enquête en ligne qui a été également distribué via les réseaux sociaux et par nos réseaux personnels ou professionnels. Et c'est donc la plupart des répondants venaient d'Afrique subsaharienne francophone. Et donc, au regard de cette difficulté et au regard des constats qui avaient été faits, ils ont formulé des suggestions, à savoir, par exemple, qu'il était important dans le cadre de la continuité pédagogique de se baser sur le droit à l'éducation pour tous parce qu'ils avaient le sentiment que leurs enfants n'avaient pas vraiment le droit à une éducation comme les autres. L'autre recommandation était aussi de les associer à la définition concernant les réponses éducatives pendant cette période difficile. Et puis, sur le long terme, il préconisait que les enfants handicapés soient inscrits parmi l'éducation des enfants handicapés soit inscrite dans les priorités de la politique éducative nationale. Et aussi de prendre en compte les spécificités du handicap dans toutes les réponses éducatives, que ce soit dans les situations de crise ou d'urgence, et donc la nécessité de renseigner les données concernant les besoins de ces enfants et les réponses qui leur sont apportées. Et puis, il y avait une question subsidiaire concernant les filles en situation de handicap. Il était question de savoir s'il y avait des mesures prises spécifiquement concernant les filles et subsidiairement concernant les filles en situation de handicap. Il est apparu qu'il n'y avait pas de mesures spécifiques et comme commentaire, on a pu lire que c'est un peu inquiétant la situation des filles handicapées parce que ce serait possible qu'elles soient victimes de violences, qu'elles soient exploitées pour des fins inavouées, qu'elles soient exploitées pour des fins économiques et qu'elles n'aient pas la possibilité de bien continuer leur école, quand bien même l'on sait que dans ces contextes-là, c'est parfois difficile ou c'est parfois difficile de retrouver des filles en situation de handicap à l'école à cause des pesanteurs par sociaux, économiques ou bien culturels. Ce qui nous a amené dans un deuxième temps au cours de l'année 2021 à partir des résultats que l'on avait obtenus de creuser un peu plus loin à travers le projet que l'on a dénommé Notre Voix, qui était axé spécifiquement sur les questions qui pouvaient entraver la scolarisation des enfants, des filles en situation de handicap. Et donc, dans ce projet, nous avons organisé des rencontres, des ateliers, nous avons organisé des webinaires au cours desquels on a discuté notamment des questions concernant les violences à l'égard des filles handicapées à l'école et les questions de la santé, de la reproduction des filles en situation de handicap. Donc, les recommandations que nous avons pu identifier, entre autres, c'est qu'il est important de promouvoir l'éducation des filles handicapées en éliminant, par exemple, les stéréotypes préjudiciables ainsi que les pratiques socioculturelles qui augmentent le risque de violence, en mettant en place des dispositifs pour accompagner les victimes éventuelles et puis en donnant les signalements. Et puis soutenir et accompagner les familles de diverses manières, prendre en compte les enjeux de santé de la reproduction pour les filles en situation de handicap. Et puis pour pousser les familles à comprendre l'éducation des filles handicapées, c'est important. Faire en sorte qu'elles aient des modèles qui peuvent inspirer ou briser les tabous, briser les stigmas et les préjugés. Donc, voilà ce que j'avais à partager avec vous ce soir dans le cadre de cet atelier. Et donc, notre appel serait qu'il est important de tenir compte des leçons de la pandémie, de tenir compte des questions de genre pour arriver à réaliser effectivement une éducation inclusive concernant les personnes en situation de handicap. Je vous remercie pour votre aimable attention et pour savoir sur nos deux projets et les recommandations. Le projet COVID-19 expérience des apprentissages à distance concernant les élèves handicapés est disponible sur notre site. Il va être publié très bientôt, de même que la compilation de notre activité concernant le projet Notre Voix. Merci beaucoup.
Good morning and good afternoon, good evening. My name is Dragana Cherichmilovanovic, and I'm a director of European Regional Office of Disability Rights International. My organization has documented situation in institutions across the world for nearly 30 years. While segregation of children with disabilities is widely documented when it comes to traditional places such as psychiatric hospitals, so-called orphanages, social care homes, what has remained under investigated is relation of education and institutionalization and use of boarding schools to segregate children with disabilities as well as other children, which I will tackle upon. So it wasn't until we did our investigation in Ukraine that we discovered that tens of thousands of children were being segregated in institutions under the Ministry of Education. We have also heard now, I think that's a common knowledge, how First Nation children were segregated in boarding schools in Canada and still remain segregated across Americas. My colleagues are at the moment documenting situation in Latin America. And I think that we really need to pay attention how education and life in the community living, living in the family is interlinked and how one can drive another and how they interrelate. So while I described some of the obstacles and ways that children with disabilities have been segregated, it is also, I also witnessed firsthand how education is important for children to become reintegrated into the community. So I met a lot of children who were placed in institutions and witnessed how education, inclusive education, inclusion into mainstream school benefited and how it transformed their lives. And I agree completely that inclusive education is not only beneficial for children with disabilities and children from other marginalized groups, but for society as a whole and for children without disabilities, for typical peers that are providing support and learning to become better people. This is something that I heard from peer support group from Serbia who described their experiences of having peers with disabilities in their classrooms. So what I want to make sure really is that we cannot allow access to education to be misused and abused to segregate children with disabilities to special boarding schools, but also other marginalized groups. But we also must ensure that education is provided in mainstream schools in with typical children, with typical peers, but also with adequate support. So we cannot hear excuses that inclusive education cannot provide children with disabilities with all necessary supports. We have this excuse abused. I did recent report in Serbia where we have parents choosing boarding schools because they have no proper choice, because they have no other option and access to education. So we must be very careful when we scrutinize and when we justify use of, for example, boarding schools. I know that has been long contested, and we have to be really careful to see when boarding school is a justifiable option, but we certainly cannot justify use of boarding schools for segregation of children on the basis of disability or any other personal characteristic, nor can we use it to justify breaking of family ties or separation of children from their families at an early age. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, and thank you to everybody, to the hundreds of people who have continued to share your ideas, your energy, your advocacy, and your championship for disability inclusive education. We will quickly close because we're grateful to all of you for staying with us. We shared links in the chat and encourage everybody to please share your feedback from today's session. Share with us your ideas as we build momentum in the lead up to the Global Disability Summit in just a few weeks and beyond to really accelerate progress and ensure that the Sustainable Development Goal number 4 for inclusive education for everybody is accessible as quickly as possible. We've shared links for how everybody can join the Global Disability Summit. Please register, help spread the word. You can also submit your suggestions to the Global Disability Summit Secretariat by tomorrow, the 21st of January, for speakers during the summit. And the 26th of January is the deadline for commitments to be made and to be updated. And we have also shared contact information for joining the Inclusive Education and Early Childhood Community of Practice. Please do and help to invite others to collaborate in this advocacy on behalf of all of the co-hosts and partners who brought this workshop to you today. This is just an important beginning, and we are really grateful to all of you for making this possible, but for accelerating that progress. I'll close with just a heartfelt thank you to everybody behind the scenes who made this workshop possible. And we look forward to connecting with all of you across the globe, across countries and communities as quickly as we can. And as we continue the learning, and we look forward to really strong commitments on inclusive education and related topics at the Global Disability Summit. Thank you very much.